Hi, my name's Ian Barr and I'm from Peterborough. I've been fishing for approximately 35 years now, which seems a very long time. My favourite style of fishing has to be lock-style drifting fly fishing from a drifting boat. However, I do all the disciplines. I fish on the rivers, I fish on the small waters, but that drifting boat has a special place in my heart. Back in 2009, I became the World Flyfishing Champion in Scotland, having fished 5 sessions across 5 different venues, which without doubt is the highlight of my fly fishing career. With my dad being a fly fisherman, he obviously introduced me into fly fishing. My very first fishing trip, I can remember my first trout very well. I was about 8 or 9 years old, fishing Ringstead Grange, and it was a massive rainbow trout of 14 ounces caught on a dry fly sedge. However, my inspiration to get me into competition fishing was a good friend of mine who used to live in Nottingham called Brian Thomas, who now lives in the Orkney Islands. He was the one that said to me, "You should try competition fly fishing," and I've never looked back since. Being a competitor, I entered all the major competitions going from when I was a youth to going into a late teenager. One of my inspirations, and he's going to love me for saying this, was Dave Shipman. Absolute true competitor and one of very few anglers who I know who I think share the same hunger, the desire, that competitiveness to win. So Dave Shipman's very much a focus, one of my heroes when I was a youngster. Not so much now. I'm a competitive person. I've always played football from when I was 7 or 8 or 9, playing in all the football leagues, winning all the trophies, so that natural competitive instinct was always inside me. However, I was unaware of competitions in fly fishing until a good friend of mine, Brian Thomas, met me on the bank, saw me casting rather well and said, "You should try and enter the youth fly fishing team." And that was just like music to my ears. How do I do it? When do I do it? When do I start? So that was my lead into competition fly fishing. So once I got into competition fly fishing, I entered all the major competitions. Now, week in, week out, I was still learning. I was getting proverbially my rear end kicked by a lot of the top competition anglers, but it was a big learning process for me. And that's one tip I can give for today. If you're going into competition fishing, please learn from all your trips out. But that instinct kept me to get better and get better. And I wanted to beat these people that were competing against me eventually. Do I do much pleasure fishing? Not as much as I would like to. I am extremely competitive, as I've already said. So for me, even a leisure day with a good friend is about beating them. That's unfortunately how it is. However, I am aware I don't do enough leisure fishing as much as I used to, and I'm actually leisure fishing tomorrow. So I am trying to get more of that because I enjoy just fishing. Becoming world champion was a massive ambition of mine from when I was about 15, 16 years old. The major factor, I think, and I've written about this, and it's so true. The world championships is ultimately a team event. So as a team, we come up with the techniques, the tactics on how England would win the gold medal. And I did predict a gold medal about 9 months before the event. However, there was one venue where England failed to catch a fish, and with half an hour to go, I was the one team member that took that one chance that came between the whole team. It was an incredibly tough venue and it was lock or. So that one fish which just measured in the gauge, and to be honest, the controller in the boat didn't want to measure it. He thought it was undersized. That one fish was 21.1 centimeters long. So that one individual fish was the decisive factor in me becoming world champion. Without that fish, I wouldn't have been world champion. I can indeed. It took an olive cruncher, size 12 on a dropper, fished with a bibio hopper. The bibio hopper was acting as the dry fly and the little cruncher behind it was there as a nymph. So I used the bibio hopper as like an indicator, and immediately with first chuck, it shot away, strike, fish on. Game over. So being world champion, it happened so quickly, and being brutally honest, it didn't sink in for quite some time afterwards. I came home and my wife and my kids had built me a big banner saying, our daddy's a world champion hanging from the house. I think that was a sinking in factor, because it's a long, long process. We're there for 2 weeks and you're physically exhausted. So you get the world championship, you go to bed, you fall asleep. I couldn't drink because I was driving home early in the morning. But the next day I got home and there was this great big banner. And then I got emails and phone calls about 2 or 3 weeks. So in that 2 or 3 week period, it slowly began to sink in thinking, I'm actually the best in the world at my chosen sport. An amazing feeling that will never, ever go. Never. And from the moment I won it, when the results were announced, Ian Green with the team manager, we've seen the organisers coming through with the results, pinning them up at the back of the hotel. I couldn't eat my food. I sat there, my meal was there. I didn't know if I'd won it or ever I'd been pipped, because I knew there were some people very, very close. Couldn't touch my food for feeling sick. And then Ian Greenwood, the manager, slipped away without the team knowing, and he came bounding back, bearing in mind he's getting on for his late 60s, leapt this barrier and threw me in the air saying, you are world champion. Never take that away. I wouldn't say I've never used it in a restaurant, but I have used it to my favour in many things. It just helps, you know. People, they see, for example, the top I'm wearing, or they see this world champion today. CV is a good thing. They've seen it on my CV, and in my current role, so one of the senior business executives is big into fly fishing, and actually buys my products. So it maybe swings a few things. I ought to try it in a restaurant, shouldn't I, Jeff? I might give that a go. I think to be good at anything, whether it's my day-to-day job, my fishing, my football, if I go into something, it's 100% or nothing. So I think it's dedication and time that are critical to succeed. Certainly my chosen path in my career outside of fishing helps. I do a lot of analysis, a lot of thinking, a lot of studying. So it's exactly the same when I go fishing. Every single offer, take, or 10 minutes without a fish is analysed, and the thought process is constantly going through my head. Everyone's got the same flies, everyone's got the same tackle available to them. It is down to individual, but everyone is capable. You know, I'm no bright spark, but I use my analysis skills and thought process to understand, why am I not catching? Why am I catching this fish? Why did that fish take that fly? So if you do that with every 10, 15 minutes of your fishing day, it slowly builds up this massive memory bank. And you know, you can just give me one scenario and I'll have memories of about 10 scenarios. You know, I can get thrown into a position tomorrow and say, go and catch a fish. And I can go to the memory bank and capture that thought and bring that back and use that to my advantage anywhere you put me in the world. Okay. To fish and get to the highest level, and I've actually had emails as recent as this week on that very same question. And the very answer I gave was, you need dedicated time and commitment. It's difficult now, I've got a family, but I still try and work around as best I can. But you need the time and you need the commitment, and I've touched on it before, the willingness to win. You've got to be ruthless and competitive and have that desire, that willingness in you to win. And that's what I saw in Scotland. I fished in 20 odd world European teams. That team in Scotland had something I've not seen in any other team. 4 or 5 anglers hungry, starving for that world championship. Painful memories. European champion with 3 hours to go in Norway, 2007. I'd fished 3 lake venues, a river venue, I'd got a fourth, second, a third, another third. I was going to this last session as European champion with 3 hours left. But overnight, the rivers had flooded with about 3 or 4 foot of sort of Willy Wonka chocolate factory style rivers coming down. It was horrendous. But I knew my nearest competitor had drawn the lake, which wasn't affected by the rain, so I knew it was going to be tough. However, I caught 2 fish on this session, which was 2 more than I thought I was going to get. And unfortunately, the Portuguese chap caught well on the lake, and he pipped me by 2 points. And there is no worse position than second, and everyone would tell you that. If you're a competitor, second is the worst place, especially when you're leading the way with 3 hours to go. Can't think of any. The only weakness I have, and I wouldn't say it's a weakness, it's how I am. And if you do know me, so you'll know that I like to share everything. I will be fishing in major championships, and at the end of the day, the guy next to me is a friend, and in most competitions, I have an open box. At a world championship, sorry, that won't happen. In a European championship, that will not happen. But in most competitions, whether it's England internationals at home, in the home internationals, Bob Church Classics, any other event, I pretty much have an open box. And I share information. I fish with people where you spend 8 hours and everything's kind of cup-handed and they don't talk to you and it's all secretive. That's no fun for me. And if you know me, I do like a bit of fun. Superstitions. I do go back to the same rods in competition fly fishing. I do use an Enigma 8-weight. It's a great all-round rod, and you know, I can fish any competition I want, and that is my first choice. But other than that, I'm not really superstitious, but I must use my Enigma rod. Oh, great question. Okay, my top three fly patterns. Stuck on a desert island, I'm allowed three patterns. It would have to be a cruncher. I love my crunchers. Probably, if I was forced into a pattern, probably be my plain cutthroat cruncher pattern. It has caught me so many fish over the last 3 years. So many, and so many good fish as well. That would probably be, if it was one fly, it would be a cruncher, because I'll catch them at 365 days of the year. I wouldn't be without a big red, which is a dry fly. Again, it will catch, there's going to be times where you need to catch quality fish and they're very finicky. A big red, which sits perfectly in the film, if it's ginked correctly, will catch these fish every day of the year, as long as they're feeding on the surface. I'm going to have to say a blob, probably a tequila, which is a two-tone yellow and orange with a flash tail. As brutal as they can be, unfortunately, it is lethal if fished correctly. And you know that you see all these things, yobs with blobs. End of the day, I'm a competitor. I fish to win. Sometimes, and more often than not, unfortunately, that is the quickest method. So it would have to be a tequila blob. So I've picked a dry fly, a nymph, and a blob. But if forced into one, it would be the cruncher. Inspires me now? Not really, in terms of fishing. Inspired me, yes. Stuart Pearce. Now, Stuart Pearce, to me, again, he was so competitive on the pitch. That ball was his ball and he wanted it. That world medal was mine and I wanted it. He has that desire and that hunger that I see in a handful of fly fishermen in today's world. Thought more about what they were doing. And red trout fishermen. You laugh, but Trout Fisherman has all the tips. I write articles in there. I tell people, I email people. In fact, I had a good example of emailing some guy who was fishing one of my Airflow World Bank Masters Championships, one of the bank events recent weeks. He emailed me for about 2 weeks leading up to the event on techniques, leader length, diameter, fly choice. I gave him all the detail for him to turn up on the morning with something completely different. I can all but try. I've been extremely fortunate to fish all around the world, but I always pick, now I cannot remember the name of the river, but it's Swedish Lapland, simply because of the sheer beauty, the fact that I was fishing for pure wild grayling, pure wild brown trout on dry fly. The river was vast. We were 2 or 3 hours from any kind of housing. It was just stunning. So it has to be Swedish Lapland. The name of the river escapes me, unfortunately. How long we got? Okay. The good in fly fishing. Okay. Well, the good thing about fly fishing in the UK is we have masses of choices of venues. There are so many places you can go fly fishing, whether it's small waters, lakes, the rivers, a little bit sparse around the Midlands where I live, but there is a vast, vast amount of water available to the fly fishing angler. There must be some more good than that. Let's start with the bad. I was actually warned by Chris Ogborn, very, very good friend of mine, back in 1997, when I asked, what do I need to do to get into this world team? He said to me, you need to fish rivers. You've proven you can fish lakes, but you need to fish the rivers. And he said, but a little word of warning. He said, when you're at the top, you are going to be shot at from every angle. He was so right. You know, I've been accused of cheating, fixing, paying, bribing, call it what you like, at every level. It's incredible. But it's the minor few, but it is out there. That to me is the bad in fly fishing, and several times I have been so close just to walking away from it, because I give it everything to have somebody jump on a forum, jump on the phone, jump on the email, and accuse me of blatantly cheating is just beyond belief. But they're out there. That's the bad in fly fishing in the UK. And it's in every sport. You know, you get to the top and you're there to be shot at. But to see it from people who you thought you knew, who you thought were friends, it's pretty low. And I've written articles in the magazine and people have written back. Instead of saying, great article, you know, I'm giving everything to help people learn. That's my nature. It's what I do. But to have people write in with some of the pedantic letters I've seen on little things like, why is Iain Barr wearing waders? You're not allowed to wear waders. In fact, you are allowed to wear waders, but I was stood on the shoreline, on the rocks, not in the water. Little things like that, and the fact that my life jacket wasn't clipped in. Why are people looking for that? That's what puts me down in fly fishing, and as I said, I've several times very nearly walked from it, because why do I bother? That's the bad. Plenty of uglies. We've had the good, we've had the bad. Do you want me to start on the uglies? Do you still fish, Jeff? All right. There you go, there's the uglies. Are there any more? Not at all. But I will win it. I've entered it twice. I've had a second and a nothing. But I will win it. But no, I don't feel incomplete. When I win the European title, I'll be complete. Good question, brave question. You know, I am married, I've got family. I probably spend too much of my time away from those. So if I was to say when it comes to an end, I'll be spreading a lake, nah, I shall be next to my wife. No ashes on the lake, I'm afraid. The trout can rest in peace that I'm not there.